one concern we have in putting in more policy is the fact that listing every single exclusion or substitution. The new state law has said that classes that meet certain guides, certain content areas can be substituted for algebra 2 or substituted for a science class, and they do not approve your individual curriculum. That is a decision that the counselors, the principals, we look at and say, well, this class could meet that content. If we did not list every single class and substitution in board policy, we could essentially keep someone from graduating who said, well, I have this science class, and this science class. I should earn credit, but it's not in the policy. So that was one of the concerns of trying to list every alternate class that you could take as a substitution. Back when they just said 4 credits math, 4 credits, it was a little bit easier. Now they are listing all of these substitutions. So it's certainly up to the board in terms of how they want to do it and everyone's definition of how easy it is to change board policy.
Well, I have a question. Where exactly are the administrative guidelines?
Right here, 0132.2.
I've never, it says, informed when anything's been changed.
Can we read it to you real quick?
I'll answer that question for you, Pam. When we contracted with NEOLA to do the board policy,
right.
It was their recommendation that we complete board policy and then go back and do right. the administrative guidelines. We have just received the packet of administrative guidelines from NEOLA relatively recently. And so as soon as we get this piece done, because this is kind of on our desk, we were immediately going to go to administrative policy. We all feel very strongly that we need to get that done as quickly as possible. We now have NEOLA's pro formas so to start looking at. So as soon as we get all this done, that's the next step.
No, that 1,000 policy is different than the administrative guidelines.
That 0132.2 is administrative guidelines. The board shall delegate to the superintendent or designate the function of specifying required actions and designing the detailed arrangements under which the school will be operated. These detailed arrangements shall constitute the administrative guidelines governing schools which are not inconsistent with statuses or regulations of the school, of the state board of the policies of the school. Or the policies of the sport. Such administrative guidelines shall be binding on the employees and the students of the district when issued. The superintendent or designee shall be delegated the authority to take necessary action in circumstances not provided for in board policy, provided that such action shall be reported to the board at the next meeting following such an action. However, we haven't had that situation. This completely takes graduation requirements out of the hands of the Board of Education. I don't think that's a good idea. It is our responsibility to be setting our graduation requirements. I don't think we can do this. I don't think this is a good plan at all. I understand other districts are doing it, and that's great for them, but I think we're better than them.
Yes, any other discussion from board members? Yes.
I was just going to say, I appreciate that the legislature is moving rather quickly. No, I'm sorry. They don't move quickly, but what they do, they want it done yesterday. That's what I meant to say. And so I appreciate that sometimes that's going to put policy in conflict with something. But, you know, we've had stuff in the past in policy. We're like, maybe we missed something before, no matter how many eyes went over, we missed something, so we have to go back and fix it. Or there's been a policy change and we have to go back and fix it. I really, like I said, I don't really care if the districts are doing it. I really like the detail we had. I really think it's important to be in policy. I hear what you're saying. I get what you're all saying. But I think to take us out of board policy, whose job it is, to do this stuff, the graduation requirements and all that stuff, I kind of have a big check on that.
Could it be created as an addendum to this?
Well, basically, that's what the administrative guidelines are. I mean, administrative guidelines just drill down and give us more detail. But I think, in agreement with you two about that it is the one thing that we do, or we're supposed to do, in setting guidelines for
graduation.
I'm uncomfortable with
Any other?
Why can't we keep our, I mean, I know we're doing.
Well, we can't keep our policy at the moment. Here's the issue, our policy does not address some of the recent changes. What I think we could do, of course, we would need legal counsel on this. We could write our own policy and then ask for legal review, because we still must meet the mandate of the state for all those swaps and substitutions. So Neola's answer to that was this, with the administrative guidelines. That was kind of their way of trying to answer that. You could certainly write something. We would need legal guidance on it to make sure that we were not excluding anything, because we cannot write a policy that is in conflict with the state law of graduation.
Well, could we put something as basic in our policy, in the policy about graduation requirements, and reference our administrative guidelines with everything that's spelled out here?
So write the administrative guidelines before using the policy?
Well, I guess in that case you'd have to. I mean, you'd have to. We could reference the administrative guidelines for our specific graduation requirements, incorporating these last changes of the last three pages that Neola is giving us.
Okay.
But just make a reference to graduation requirements as set forth by the board, because yes, whenever there's a change in graduation requirements, it does come before the board. If we say you need 4 years of art, that has to come before the board for approval to change it for graduation. So if somehow we could, and maybe you might want to run this by our legal.
So maybe in the, like the, not coming across that paragraph on page five, the one, two, third, where it says the board shall award regular high school diplomas, I assume will, et cetera, there, possibly adding it in there as referenced by.
You know, nobody says this.
Well, but I think what I'm hearing Sharon say, and Mary, and I don't want to put words in your mouth, is that you want the absolute, you want the specifics of the fact that you need 4 credits of English, 3 credits of electives, 2 of this, like that, versus the how they may earn credit.
Right.
But this statement, this paragraph that you just read, Lisa, says the board shall award a regular high school diploma to every student enrolled in this district who meets the requirements of graduation established by this board.
Correct.
The Michigan Department of Ed, and is provided by state law. Maybe all we need to do is, after established by this board, in parentheses, see guidelines for specifics. For specifics,
right.
Or for, you know.
Correct.
So we would not put all of this, like say all of this.
The only problem with that is that the administrative guidelines have nothing to do with the board.
But this statement in here is going to say that it's already been approved by the board. It says, I just
don't need to reference the administrative guidelines for graduation requirements.
It says here,
it's
already been established by this board. Uh-huh. Look at paragraph, on page 507, if you have it in front of you, and I just read it. It meets the requirements of graduation established by this board.
So while administrative guidelines in general are, the administration can change because the board policy specifically says that graduation requirements must have board approval, nothing can come in or out of administrative guidelines related to graduation without the approval. Because that's what this says.
However, administrative guidelines very specifically says they don't need any board approval.
Well, here it says, yeah, this is policy. And
well,
they would have to say it and just say that.
If we change that, you don't need board approval for administrative guidelines.
Graduation
requirements into administrative guidelines if you want them to be board approved.
Maybe what? I think possibly.
You can't have both.
But what's getting confusing here is graduation requirements and credits. What we had in the past, if you notice, was very specific about credits, the amount of credit you had. The board policy, the new board policy that's being recommended, says they need to report requirements of graduation established by the board. What we have removed is this very specific credit word about 4 credits of this, 3 credits of that. The reason for that is, for example, 4 credits of English language arts. When this policy was written, the options for English language arts were very basic. Freshman English, sophomore English, maybe some composition classes. Now, we have things that fall under that umbrella of English that we don't detail out here. So possibly, if we had a compromise between Linda and what you're saying, is that we could add with the, you know, meets requirements of graduation established by this board and put in some language there about the minimum amount of credits or something to that effect. Because graduation requirements can be earned in all these different ways, and we must specify that, because when this policy was written, online courses didn't exist. So we have to recognize the fact that you can earn it online, you can earn it by testing out. Those are some items we must have in the policy, but I think we could add something more specificity in terms of credit, if that would help make it more clear.
We've had a lot of discussion on this. Is there any consensus on the board? I think there's 3 ideas. We have this language that's been presented to us. We have a fair amount of concern about eliminating the specificity within the board policy. And then the other discussion is that this does still state that requirements of graduation established by this board. That would be part of policy if this was adopted. Is there any, I'm looking for, you know, do we move on from here, or ask Lisa to come back with the language she's talking about? Any ideas?
I think we need to come back with something. Doesn't work.
Yeah. You know, I think as a parent too, when you want to know, well, what are the requirements, or, you know, what are we going
to go to policy?
And I realize that I'm going to be in high school, but, you know. But the idea that this is the policy is the board.
I don't know what you're saying, but
I've got a big check here, so maybe we do go and figure out, you know, what else we do, or like you suggested, maybe having us review our stuff like a legal, give us an idea on it.
I have a question. Is our relationship with the OLA Neola. Isn't it, if we made a change that we submitted to them for their reading for legal basis, as opposed to going to our lawyers?
Yes. Well, here's the issue. I can ask them. On some policies, they will absolutely say, we'll write it, and they will do that. On some policies, they say, no, this is the only way that you can do it, and if you want to change it and have any type of legal backing, you have to ask someone else. So I would certainly ask them first. There are many things that must be in this policy. The only thing I'm hearing that you would want to add is our specific graduation requirements. Much of this stuff that is in here is not a choice. We have to say that you can earn it by testing out, you can earn it by CTE, all those things. We have to add all this stuff about the Michigan American curriculum and many of those things. So what I would just be asking them is, can we put something in there about our delineated grade?
Well, for instance, we already had testing out. We already had a bit about, you know, IBC plus on a final exam. So that was already part of what we did.
Correct. And we just didn't have the items related to the personal curriculum and notifying people that there were some little things here and there. And that it's the swapping. So we have to just make sure that we are covered on the fact that we are not allowed to say you must have 4 credits of math and one of them has to be a traditional algebra 2 class. We can't do that anymore. We have to make sure that we allow for all of these changes that someone could get alternate credit. So it would be a matter of making sure we didn't miss any of those details to make sure that we weren't violating.
What is the purpose of that example alone? What is the purpose of them saying you don't have to have traditional algebra 2 anymore, but you can substitute ABCD classes? What is the thought process? I know it's a tricky question, and I'm sorry.
Yeah.
If you don't know, that's okay.
Well, I don't want to get upset about this, but I have now went possibly 18 hours without using algebra 2. So I think part of it is the fact that they put that graduation requirement in. And now they're saying you know, what we held a lot of things back, and there are ways to complete that coursework without following a traditional path of the two. So they thought they put it in there as a really high bar and that everybody should have out for two, but then they realized that they were actually holding back students who were amazing students, and algebra 2 was a stumbling block for them. And so they realized that, for example, CTE classes, many of our CTE classes can be substituted for algebra 2. By putting it in your graduation requirements, we will have to delineate every class we feel could be substituted for algebra 2.
Or you could just say something like, for the, you know, state standard equivalent.
And I can ask them about that. That doesn't
make it difficult. Algebra 2 or the state standard equivalent.
Or equivalence, right?
Right.
Because it could be more than one.
We can't be the only Board of Education in the entire state of Michigan who says, no, we think that board policy should reflect graduation requirements, and the board
I did not say that.
I can't imagine that Neola's not going to see this ever or hasn't seen them already. Or somebody says, I think graduation requirements need to remain with the board.
Well, I think it should be recognized that we are a very unique board, but this, it was just a example of what we can do. Because of the fact that we, our current policy is not in line with state. So I would say if we are going to do this, that we would certainly, we would not be able to bring it back on Monday.
I'd like to propose that we've heard enough on this conversation that maybe give us another crack at it. Let us come back with something based on what we've heard, and we'll see if that is any better. But it won't be next month.
Sure. Absolutely.
Okay. Thank you. I was actually saying, I'm impressed if it's only $18.
Yeah.
Because to not have a high school diploma, it sets students on a trajectory for the rest of their lives. We do not, we are going to keep our schools safe, and we do not want to accept these students back into our schools, but this is an online program that allows a student, a kid, to have a second chance without putting students in harm's way. So yes, I am, and we are making that recommendation.
So a student that shows up with a knife or a gun, and it's not a big deal, and we go ahead and expel them at the principal's request, and you go ahead and say, let's just put them back over at the tolerance center, because those kids don't matter enough, and we can put a violent offender over there.
On an online program.
We have put violent offenders over there, and even in an online program, they still have access to the teachers and have access to the facilities, and we still have to provide those things, and that's okay with you. And you go ahead and go to the attorneys to say, how can I make this work? How can I make what I'm doing, which is completely wrong for our district, okay? Let me get the board to go ahead and approve this. I have four board members that will give me anything I want, including putting violent offenders over at home.
All right, stop. One person at a time, please. Sharon?
I want her to stop saying that.
Okay.
And but if she has four votes, she does. She knows this.
Okay. Excuse me. We're going to go through other board members. We're going to allow people to talk. Thank you.
I have another question.
Amy.
Violent offenders being, if a student were to bring a gun or a knife, then they are carrying an illegal weapon, then are they not prosecuted and would they not be incarcerated?
Correct. That's why there's the permitted by Michigan federal law. So if they are prosecuted and incarcerated, then no, we would not reinstate them in any of our programs.
They'd go into our program through.
Well, I can't say where they would go because once.
If they went to the jail that we support, then.
Then they'd be in the jail, like Mr. Kowalski said earlier, yeah. Because we do provide the educational.
Right.
I'd
like to see if there's other board members that like to comment, and then I'd like to make a comment too.
I understand, and I do think it's best that if a student can do online work and earn their diploma, I think that's what we should be doing for students. I think the issue is coming up because this has taken place where students have been, we have voted to expel students, and then we're finding out that they are actually enrolled in our district, through an alternative program. So I guess the issue is, if the board is expelling a student for one of these issues, and then they're being admitted into online programming, or they're showing up at the Pellerin Center for some kind of online programming, it's been off-putting to some of the board members that we're not aware of that. So I don't have a problem with this, but I think that if we're expelling a student, my expectation is that they're gone from our district. My expectation has never been that they're showing up next week. You know, if it's an online class at home, it's a different story than if it's an online class that they have to show up here with other students at the Pellerin Center at night to take. So I guess the issue for me is that the board needs to be made aware of this, and there needs to be some policy in place that if that is indeed what's going to happen with certain students that we're voting to expel, then we also need to vote, look at the circumstances, and vote on whether or not that student, with whatever issue is that we're expelling them for, should be allowed to physically show up in one of our buildings with other students and participate in some online program.
I would just like to interject that maybe I didn't make that clear at the beginning. Unless that student is otherwise reinstated, and we still have that sentence in there, students are expelled from and may petition for reinstatement. My understanding, and maybe you should clarify this, Jackie, this is not the case, but this is not for us. You would not expel, and then we would enroll. These students petition for reinstatement.
I've never seen a petition for reinstatement from any of these students.
This devalues the Pellerin Center massively. This just says if you get expelled from Lance Cruz, you cannot go to the Pellerin Center.
The power incentive is not for that. The power incentive is for the kids that work hard and just need extra. Well, they need a different method. They need a different way. They can succeed. When they expel somebody, the whole point of expelling them is, hey, take some time, figure it out, and apply for reinstatement in a year. Otherwise, what's the point of reinstatement? What's the point of expulsion? All you're doing is devaluing the power incentive.
Okay, you allow other board members to comment?
I don't think that they don't matter.
Thank you. Okay, I'd like to...
Can I make a comment before you...
Okay, please. Yes, Amy.
When we have a student who's been expelled for a reason less than desirable, a gun, a knife, something like that, and they go on to an online, or assaulting the teacher, if they go on to an online program, my understanding is that they may have to come in to the Pelham Center for some assistance on this program. Can we put it in our guidelines that when they come in the building, they enter the building, a parent must be with them? It is the parent's responsibility to make sure their child is educated. It is the parent's responsibility to make sure their child follows the guidelines when they have violated the guidelines. And that way we don't have to worry about our teachers or our other members. If the parents are there, they're responsible for their kids.
One person at a time. Sharon?
That's true.
Sharon?
That's a good point. But once even if you take the child to the building, once they're in there, you're not there anymore, and whatever could happen, this will happen without you.
No, they can't leave. They have to be there.
So you're telling a parent they have to quit their job?
No, kid, we don't need me, and it's their responsibility. It's their child.
I don't think we could. That's cute. Some other parents said, I don't think we could possibly do that. Would be incredibly disruptive.
Okay.
What if you're talking to a single parent who's working a weird shift job, whatever? I think the point that Pam had made, to Mary's point, is they're both good points. I think I always thought when they were doing the online classes, they were online way, and most of us think about it. It's like something from home.
That is true.
So I wasn't thinking they were being admitted to Pelham and doing online classes physically in the building. To me, it was, if you're doing an online class, you're not physically in any of our buildings.
So that was my question. If they're doing, if they're expelled and they're doing online at home. They're not coming to Pelham.
All right,
so
let's get the superintendent. She had asked for a minute.
How are they receiving support if it's online and they're doing?
Let's let the superintendent answer.
I think that's a good point for clarification, and I do need to go back and get more information. But what I understand to be true, and I will get the rest of the information and bring it back, is that this online is in their homes. It is not in the building. So this is not them coming to school and then going into our computer lab and doing it. This is students doing online programming from home.
If you buy them,
excuse me,
what?
I know.
Well, would you allow the superintendent to speak? Let's let the superintendent. Are you done?
No, I was going to just say, no. I do believe it is true that they are able to come in for some teacher support. I think it might be, it's like once every week, once every 2 weeks, and it is after school hours. But, and Lisa, unless you know that for sure, I can come back with that information. But what I am saying is it is online programming from home. They're not coming into the building.
Our classes that are online in the buildings are primarily credit recovery. It is not just online programming. And Jake, you are correct. There are times they come into the building, but each child is different, and some are done over the phone or virtually, so not every student comes in. But I think that is something that you can certainly ask to be more specific in the policy to address online.
Having served on a reinstatement committee for the past, 2-3 years, I don't ever recall a student saying that they came into Pelham to take online. They specifically, because we would ask them, what have you been doing for the last year? And they would say, well, I was doing my online work at home, and I was...
That's because they're doing their online outside of Lance Cruz, where they can do online.
They were our students.
No, not if they're applying for reinstatement. Why don't you just tell the board senator to dump you around?
I'm going to get a chance to talk.
Go ahead.
I find your tone extremely objectionable.
Yeah.
The role of our we are to educate children. Your reference to why and how we do it is contrary to the things that I believe this district should represent, and as an educational entity for our community, that we want to be. We've all made mistakes in our lives, and would you let me talk? I've listened to you enough.
Your tone is objectionable.
Yes. We've all made mistakes, and to provide a student and to provide them with the opportunity to succeed, you know, to make a difference is part of what is, I feel, our high obligation. And I think the district needs to have that flexibility to deliver services to students, and I expect that this board will support that, and I expect our community will support that. Here we are. The superintendent has asked for some opportunity to get a little more clarification. I've heard the discussion before, and actually Amy and I tomorrow have a reinstatement committee, and I can say that not all students have been reinstated, as Amy well knows. We do take into consideration the safety and the impact to our students and community. Again, I think all board members take that as a high responsibility. We discussed that earlier today. And so we'll look forward to receiving some more background on this. And we'll listen to board members as we have to.
Can I make one request?
Yes.
And I agree with you. My request would be that when the expulsion comes before the board in the confidential packet, that if a student is going to be taking online classes, because we haven't been notified in the past, there's notification in that packet, and then there's a reasoning behind it. I don't know.
And the type of online.
I'm all for it, but we need to be told. Us voting for an expulsion and it not actually being an expulsion are two very different things. So,
I think that's good.
Yeah, the only thing I would mention is what has ended up happening is a student gets expelled, and then we start working with the student and family, if it's deemed appropriate, to figure out if there's a way to get here on the online. What we could do is, so we don't have it all carved out yet, because we haven't expelled the student and had those conversations with the parents yet. What we could do is put in the expulsion packet, you know, that we want to be able to work with the parent to offer this. We don't know what it looks like yet, you know, as far as what the coursework would be. And then the board would know that it was our hope and desire that when you approve the expulsion, that you are, you know, acknowledging that we want to go on to that next step if the parent and the student chooses to. So we could do that.
Correct, because some students. Okay, so this board should remember that every single student for the last year and a half that we have expelled has been put in the online program. You don't know about it because nobody asked. And when we asked, we learned that every single student for the last year and a half, and we've had some seriously violent students in the last year and a half, every single one has been put right back in the online program. The board has never been told about it. This is Mrs. Johnson just trying to cover her backside because she's been...
I find that objectionable again. That is a statement of... It's just plain rude.
I'm sorry.
Would you please try to conduct yourself decently?
Please. Well, I would ask the same of you, Tom.
That it goes both ways. It's gotten both ways.
Yeah. Yes, it is.
This is inappropriate.
All right. Well, so we're going to get some more information on
this. I'm sorry. I think our college students deserve a whole lot better than to be the dumping grounds.
Yeah. I'm sorry.
So a couple of things. One is we are probably going to need to do something about the timeline. We have an item on the agenda that must be addressed tonight, it's a time-sensitive issue. I know we have a 9:30 and we have have a vote that we need to have, so I'd like to just make sure that everyone's aware we must get to another agenda, and so I'm hoping we can.
We're at 9:27, we're scheduled to end at 9:30, we need the board action to extend the timeframe. Is there discussion on extending the timeframe?
My motion would be to extend the timeframe to be able to complete the agenda.
Second.
Support. We have second, we have a motion and support. Is there discussion on the motion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Nay.
Okay, the motion carries. We are extending the agenda.
How long?
The term was to complete the agenda, so we're moving on.
Can we change the order so we can get that stuff done if these people want to?
I'm
they're waiting for us to vote on something and they want to go home instead of listening to this.
I think as a board member, I need to apologize to everyone for the length of this, because this is the first time we've done policy in this format. We've done away with our committee structure. This is the type of stuff that we dealt with on the committee level, and it's grueling. It's really grueling, so I need to apologize to everyone who's having to listen to this.
I would like to say something too concerning that. This is a great example of changing a 60-year procedure, the way this board operated very well, to going to these two meetings, and here we are hashing out things that we should be doing in committees and having a recommendation come to the board. All this can have worked out. People don't need to hear all this.
There is only three members on that committee. This way, we heard from everyone's opinion, and everyone had
an opinion. Well, obviously, you heard
it always came back to the board meeting.
It always came back to the board. The board had the final say, and the board has always worked on the idea that the individuals were put on those committees. There was a balance. You know, everything was heard, you know, all the way down the line, so when it came back, if you didn't hear it here, you heard it there. But we can't micromanage everything that this community does at the board table. Now, I just feel like this is a good example tonight. I mean, trying to be patient, but it's just hard when you hear the trivia and the remarks and the unprofessional way we treat each other and the way we treat our superintendent, which we hired, we should be supporting.
Well, Sharon, and then I'm going to ask that there was a motion to extend the time frame for the long, and that passed, but I'd take it past, so we take a short break. But Sharon,
all I was going to say was, we talked about this. I think the idea of an open committee structure is fine. It subjects everyone to hang around, but we do all this. But I would also say, we can't cancel the committee structure we used to do in there with only three board, report out, work, have a discussion at the table, and still be done at 9:30. That is just impossible. We can't get the work done if we do that. So if we want to do it all right here, the 9:30 thing is going to have to go away.
All right, let's take a short break to 9:37 and we'll be back.